Hello students, today we are going to learn a new chapter, that is water. Though we have been learning many aspects of water since last few years and also it is an important part of our life, still there are many new concepts about water which can be covered in 9th standard. So before we go ahead, I would like to share a PPT for you so that you will have a reference document in front of you. So please hold on. Let me share the screen so that my explanation will go along with the PPT. I hope you are able to see this properly. Water. Now, water is a compound and not an element. This point is going to be covered later, but still, I would like to start with it, that water is a compound and not an element. But if you see components of water, it is made up of, as you know, hydrogen and oxygen. So two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. And this ratio is fixed and components or elements are also fixed. So irrespective of the place from where you can take the sample of water, concentration of water is going to be the same. So water is a compound and not an element. Chemical formula of water is H2O and chemical name, or you can say IUPAC name of water, is dihydrogen monoxide. Di is 2, so H2, and oxide 1. So dihydrogen monoxide H2O. We will go ahead. Introduction. One of the scientists, Ostwald stated that almost all the chemical processes which occur in nature takes place among solutions in water. Water is elixir of life. Elixir is magic, definitely, because we are alive due to water only. So you can say whatever gives us life, or because of something we are able to exist, that must be a magic. So water is a magic. So it is an elixir of life. And as you know, more than 70% of our body has water. Third point, it is found in natural state. Water has received some form of treatment. If then it is known as treated water. As you know, chemical name of water is dihydrogen monoxide. You will go ahead. Importance of water in our life. It is vital, that is important, very much essential for the growth of plant and animal life. Human body also needs water to sustain. Third one, industrial processes require water, be it cooling or be it transportation or draining of waste material. Even that should be done by water. Even agriculture, transportation, power generation plants require water. When it comes to transportation, you can think of sheep or yak, with the help of which either we can go from one place to another, or even goods can be carried. Occurrence of water, where can water be found? Two possibilities, either in free state or combined state. Free state, again, three states of matter. So solid, liquid, gas. Solid, in the form of ice, snow or frost. Liquid, again, there will be three options, three possibilities. On the earth's surface, it is river water, lake water or sea water. Liquid below the earth's surface, well water, moisture in the soil. Liquid above the earth's crust, dew. Then third state of matter, gaseous state, water vapor or clouds or fog. Now in combined state. Now when you say combined state, we have already learned water of crystallization. That point is directly associated with this point, that is water in the combined state. If you take an example of copper sulfate, hydrated copper sulfate, if you see the formula, it is CuSO4.5H2O. It means copper sulfate, hydrated copper sulfate, has copper, sulfur, oxygen and 5 molecules of water. So you can say that water, as far as hydrated copper sulfate is concerned, water is present there in combined state. There is loose combination between water molecule and copper sulfate salt. So we will go ahead. Water is present in combined state in all living beings. It is also present in the hydrated salt, Example, CuSO4 5H2O. Water covers 75% of Earth's surface and 70% water is there in our body. It is also present in green vegetables, milk, etc. We will go ahead. Water cycle. Again, we have been learning water cycle since last 3 years, I would say. Maybe from standard 4th or standard 5th, we have been learning water cycle. Water cycle, recycling of water naturally. So circulation of water from the Earth's surface by evaporation to the atmosphere. Evaporation takes place due to sun's heat. And second, back to the Earth's surface as rainwater. So it's a circulation. So you can say it is, water cycle is nothing but natural distillation. Just for a reference, you can see the diagram. The water cycle, evaporation, then condensation, precipitation, again it comes down as rainwater, and then again it will be evaporated. So this is how same water will be recycled. You can say same water will be purified, distilled and recycled. So this is called water cycle. Now one point I would like to add here, that when rainwater comes down, while it comes down, there are many pollutants present in the atmosphere. Example is CO2, carbon dioxide. Now when that carbon dioxide is mixed with water, then H2O plus CO2, that gives us H2CO3, which is carbonic acid. But that is not a part of water cycle. I took this point just to avoid confusion, because though H2CO3, suppose you just assume that rainwater comes down, and while it comes down, it is combined with carbon dioxide and it has become acidic because of H2CO3. But again, when it is evaporated, it will not, needless to say that it will not evaporate as H2CO3, but only H2O. That is why it is also called as natural distillation. We'll go ahead. This was the first point from where we started. Water is a compound and not an element. Or I would say water is a compound, neither a mixture nor element. Water is a compound and not an element. Henry Cavendish synthesized or prepared water from its elements, that is 2 volumes of hydrogen and 1 volume of oxygen. This is by igniting them in their respective ratio, thereby leading to the conclusion that water is not an element. Antoine Lavoisier confirmed that water is a compound. H and O, that is hydrogen and oxygen, are in fixed proportion. So ratio will be 2:1 for hydrogen and oxygen. Differ from the properties of its individual elements. So the properties of water are going to be different than that of individual elements. You can just take an example of hydrogen and oxygen. Of course, we're talking about water. Out of that, let's assume oxygen. Now, as you know, oxygen supports combustion. Whatever is able to be burned, is only because of oxygen, presence of oxygen, because it supports combustion. Now, when that oxygen, which supports combustion, combines with hydrogen, it forms water. It forms a compound. Now, water, which is a compound that is made up of hydrogen and oxygen, that water does not support combustion. It is a fire extinguisher. Why? Because oxygen as well as hydrogen have lost their properties after getting combined with each other chemically. So definitely properties of water will be different from that of hydrogen and oxygen. So one of the parameters is burning or combustible or supporting combustion. Hydrogen and oxygen I was talking about. So differ from the properties of its individual elements. And last point, which is very much important, H and O, that is hydrogen and oxygen, can be separated only by chemical means and not physical means. This point is very much important, that if you just provide heat energy to water, suppose you take 1 liter of water, put it in vessel, and you start providing heat energy, it will start changing its state of matter. So from liquid, you will get water vapor. If you put it in maybe freezer, you will get again liquid to solid. So it will change the state of matter, but it will not break the bond present between hydrogen and oxygen. So if you provide heat energy, it will change the state of matter, but it will not break the bond. So by physical mean, you will not be able to separate hydrogen and oxygen. If you want to separate them from each other, you will have to go ahead with electrolysis. So by passing electric current through acidulated water, you can definitely break the bond between hydrogen and oxygen, and at two electrodes, you will have hydrogen gas and oxygen gas respectively, cathode and anode, you can say. So this point is very much important, that you cannot separate hydrogen and oxygen by physical means, but only chemical means. Natural and treated water. Natural water, as you know, rainwater, spring water, sea water, etc. Ocean also, you can say, or lake. Treated water, distilled water, pipe-borne water, chlorinated water. Distilled water, the most purified water, you can say. It is soft water and prepared by condensing steam. So distillation is done. And because it is distillation, no minerals will be present in it. It will be purest form of water. So it is the most, or you can say it is the softest water, I would say. It is soft water having no minerals because it is distilled, prepared by condensing steam. It is the purest form of water. Pipe-borne water. So you can say water that we get through our tap. So tap water, we get it from corporation. Filtration followed by chemical treatment of water. Chlorinated water. Water used in swimming pools to kill germs. So third one is chlorinated water. We'll go ahead. Universal solvent. Water is universal solvent. It's because many of the, or the best, see, the most of the students write in this way, almost all substances are dissolved in water. Rather writing this or saying this, the better sentence will be, most of the substances, or the number of substance that that is dissolved by water is more than that of any solvent. This is the better way to define water as universal solvent. Water has ability to dissolve a large number of solids. So rather than say most of or almost all, you can say large number of solids or gases. So large number of solids, salts, sugar, etc. Large number of gases, oxygen, ammonia, all these can be dissolved in water. Now there are, as far as dissolution is concerned, definitely there are three terms: solute, solvent, and solution. Solute, substance that dissolves in solvent. So suppose you can take an example of water and salt. Now you are going to add salt to the water. So salt is going to be dissolved. So salt is solute. So substance which is dissolved in the solvent. So salt is solute. Solvent, substance in which solute dissolves. So salt is going to be dissolved in water. So water is solvent. And solution, when solute is completely dissolved in solvent, then it is called as solution. It forms solution. Now let me add one point here. Whenever it comes to defining solution, you can either call it solution or true solution or homogeneous mixture. But in terms of heterogeneous mixture, you can never call it as heterogeneous solution, because even in maths also we say that whenever problem is solved, then only we can say that solution is in place. The same way, poetically, let's assume that salt is a problem. Just assume. So that salt, if is completely dissolved in water, then it forms solution, because the problem, that is the salt, is completely dissolved. So please remember this point: homogeneous solution, heterogeneous mixture. You can call homogeneous mixture or homogeneous solution, but in case of heterogeneous, it will be only mixture and not solution, because solute is to be dissolved in order to be called as solution. Solution is solute plus solvent. Now concentration. If amount of solute is more than that of solvent, then it is called as concentrated solution. Suppose amount of, let's take another example, maybe sulfuric acid, H2SO4. So if amount of sulfuric acid is more than that of water, then that solution will be called as concentrated solution. And if amount of H2SO4, that is sulfuric acid, is less than that of water, then it is called as diluted solution. So So amount of solute is more than that of solvent, then it is called as concentrated solution. And if amount of solute is less than that of solvent, then it is called diluted solution. So for now, I hope everything is clear. Whatever we discussed, I hope you have understood. So we will continue this chapter later. Thank you.